When you haven't won a Stanley Cup for 40 years, I don't care how much talent you may or may not have, you're an underdog.
The team I took over in 1982 was in the Detroit River, quite frankly.
I don't mean to be rude or anything, but you don't have any kind of a hockey club.
I knew that there were good players in Russia. The problem was there was an iron curtain.
There's no book, you know. You couldn't go anywhere and say, okay, how do you get a guy to defect? I knew one guy that spoke Russian.
I get to Helsinki, I notice a guy. I'm convinced he was their KGB guy.
Literally, we're making it up as we went along. I said, Sergei, this money's yours if you leave now.
It was interesting for me. It was like a little bit exciting.
My home phone rings, and it's some guy from the State Department. Do you know the whereabouts of Sergei Fedorov? To which I basically said, yes.
Very quickly, you're like, hey, this guy's pretty good, you know?
One of the most talented players I ever saw in my life.
Scotty Bowman knew one thing, that the Russian game is played in five-man units.
First time in NHL history, five Russian guys playing in the same unit.
That's it, let's go.
They played a different style.
It was keep away. I mean, literally, they would play keep away.
No way! What is this, hockey night in Canada or hockey night in Russia?
Hasta la vista, baby.
People questioned Scotty Bowman. They questioned if we could get it done.
They're coming over. They're going to have to play the Canadian way. They're going to have to toughen up.
It's way beyond hockey.
American, Canadian, Swedish, Russian. They're all Red Wings!
None of this matters unless we win.
Through the 70s and 80s, there was no more feared villain in the hockey world than the Red Army, the dominant Soviet national team. The national narrative made the Soviets into the bad guys. But there was no denying that every NHL fan wanted players like Sergei Fedorov or Igor Larionov on their team. So when the Iron Curtain fell, it was no surprise that Russians became some of the most celebrated stars in the league, with five of the brightest landing in Detroit.
Here comes the Russians. Oh, my.
Drawing on the unique style the Soviets were known for and struck by hockey inspiration, head coach Scotty Bowman made NHL history when he sent five Soviet-trained players on the ice as one unit.
Well, the pressure is, they're all excited. It's great. It's wonderful. Same system. However, there's a lot of pressure to make it work and to play well. Put those five Russian players on the ice together. You can bet your boot that Calgary's going to come after him with all guns flaring.
It's basically like when Pavel gets a breakaway and everyone stands up and just waits to see what's going to happen, but with five guys on the ice.
Well, you know, that was like a project of Scotty Bowman and Barry Smith. So, you know, that was... it's kind of like those two guys are founders of the Russian fight.
Each member brought something unique to the line. Fedorov was the superstar scorer. Slava Kozlov, the young blood.
Looks it ahead for Kozlov. Look at the move here by Kozlov. A Katsutona. Oh,
Igor Larionov, the professor, led the unit from the right wing. Anchoring the blue line were Slava Fetisov, one of the greatest defensemen to play the game, and Vladimir Konstantinov, a shutdown physical presence with skill to match his explosive checks. There's no doubt the Russian Five's brand of hockey changed the NHL forever. Just talk to any coach today about the importance of puck possession.
You'd come to the rink knowing you were going to win. You just didn't know what the score was going to be. We had the puck the whole night, and if we had a good game, we had the puck three-quarters of the game. If we had a bad game, we had the puck two-thirds of the game. And I can remember going on the road sometimes and beating teams 5-0, 5-1, had the puck. I mean, the other team had no chance.
They just moved the puck around. They regrouped, I don't know, five or six times before they even crossed the red line. And, you know, by the time they decided to go on the offense, the other team was either tired or just kind of confused at what was going on.
You know, when they got five Russians playing that funky, fun and the crazy style of hockey, you know, moving the puck around and doing some stuff like people never seen before. So that's what, that's the Russian Five is all about.
The Wizards of Av burned bright for three seasons, helping the Wings bring the Stanley Cup back to Hockey Town in 1997. And for the first time in 104 years, hockey's ultimate prize went to Moscow with Russian names engraved on it forever.
It's an incredible thing to do because a lot of reception and people were just happy to see the players and to see the cup and especially children. Well, there's a lot of children who are dreaming right now to one day to make some NHL team and try to win the Stanley Cup.
Scotty put together five Russians together on one line, and people thought you can't win with Russians, you can't win with all those Europeans. They were critical, and that's really, since then, everything we've done has really kind of come off of that because of the success that we had.
It was a great, you know, privilege and honor to have those guys on the ice and go out and do what they did.
The Russian Five were...
On our team, we have Russians, Germans, Swedes, you name it, we got it, and we're all one big happy family.
Привет, Шенни, иди покатайся в облаках.
That means Shanahan is a good and great man.
I love you too, my brother.
We entertain people every time we step on the ice. When you got five people thinking the same way, you can do a lot of things nobody can understand. We show the fans in Joe Louis there's different ways to play hockey.
The Soviet Union was a nation in revolution during the late 1980s. The state-run hockey program, once an international powerhouse, began to lose players to the NHL, while veterans like Igor Larionov and Vyacheslav Fetisov escaped the Iron Curtain legally. The Soviets threatened harsh consequences to young players wishing to desert their homeland.
I would ask my scouts, who's the best 18-year-old player in the world? They would say to me, Sergei Fedorov. And I'd say, where does he play? Well, he plays in Russia. The Russians and Czechs were not available because there was an Iron Curtain. Well, he said, you know, you're not going to get him. It's a wasted pick. Take him.
Selected 74th overall by Detroit in the 1989 entry draft, 20-year-old Sergei Fedorov left the Russian national team while competing in the Goodwill Games in Portland, Oregon.
It was a little bit scary, a little bit exciting. I never told my parents what I'm going to do, really, because I don't want to put them in trouble.
Jim Leitz, our executive vice president, hire spies, and they'd sneak into hotels and meet the kid in the lobby, and it was all prearranged behind the scenes. To have Fedorov get on the plane, leave his team, defect, come to Detroit.
I was willing to take some risk and some danger because I know best hockey was here.
3-on-2 for the moment now. There's Eisenman. Shot! Score! Sergei Fedorov, first goal in the National Hockey League.
Incredible talent. He added Sergei to Steve Yzerman, and down the middle, we had two incredible players.
Man, could he skate.
Here's Fedorov across the blue line. Look at the moves. He scores!
He could go from 0 to 100 in that.
Back comes Fedorov. He can wheel in a race, gets in front, score! Fedorov around the outside, on the backhand, six goals!
There you go.
He was one of the most complete players ever played. He could play any position, except for goalie.
Sergei was my first defense partner when I got here to Detroit. I don't know if he played defense before, but boy, he didn't miss a beat.
There was games where he just took over.
Sergei Fedorov, dance around a check. He comes to the net, he's in, he shoots, he scores! Fedorov!
When he decided that it was time to play, there wasn't too many things or too many people that could stop Sergei Fedorov.
Like Fedorov, Vladimir Konstantinov and Vyacheslav Kozlov defected from Russia to Detroit to begin their NHL careers.
Vladimir Konstantinov was a solid defenseman, and Slava Kozlov, he was just coming into his own.
Kozlov, who was a tough little son of a gun, they called him a water bug when we got him.
Konstantinov to Kozlov, behind the defense, Kozlov scores!
What a move.
What a great move by number 13, Kozlov.
Kozlov and Fedorov, together with Dino Ciccarelli, formed one of the NHL's most dominant lines. In 1993-94, Fedorov won the Hart Trophy, the Pearson Award, and the Selke Trophy, the first Russian to win any of those honors. The following season, as the Red Wings approached the playoffs, they traded for a fourth Russian, Slava Fetisov.
Scotty felt he's a character guy with Fedorov here and Kozlov, Konstantinov. I think he would be good for them. And as usual, Scotty was right.
Slava was really pushing to get a former teammate of his, Igor Larionov.
I was surprised when I got traded. I got a phone call from Scotty Bowman on the trade, and Scotty told me to fly to Calgary.
And I remember getting on the bus, and I looked over my shoulder and I go, hey, that's Igor Larionov. What's he doing on the bus?
Mick, we get our first look tonight at newcomer Igor Larionov. He's going to wear number 8.
Bowman put them together in Calgary that night. We'll never forget that night.
Fetisov now gives it off to Larionov, and the 5 Soviets are out there now playing as a unit.
It's an amazing feeling when you're standing on the face-off and you look around. There's Kozlov, there's Fedorov, there's Konstantinov, there's Fetisov. And we start to play the game, and then click right away.
Kozlov breaking in for a shot, can't save, rebound, score!
Calgary never touched the puck when they were on the ice.
Larionov makes one pass, now Huskroff without a stick.
It was almost like keep away out there.
Moves it to Fedorov. Fedorov fakes, gets Stillman out of the way.
I mean, it was all domination by the Russian 5.
And the Calgary Flames got 8 shots on goal. We had the puck all night.
Moving the puck around, we're making some plays.
Fedorov into the zone, drops it, Larionov, a drive, save, made, rebound, Larionov scores!
We won 3-0, and now Lions scored 2 goals.
They brought the Russian hockey into the NHL, and nobody else could play that way. Talk about ebb and flow, 10, 12, 15 passes that they would have before the puck's in the net.
Some pretty passing by the Russian 5.
You hear them dumping the puck in, you know, they wouldn't do that. Why dump it in? You got to go get it now.
I remember Igor Larionov telling me, he says, we worked so hard to get the puck, why do we want to give it away?
They would just come to center ice, and they didn't like what they saw, they went back. Start again. You know, like we see, go back, start again. What are we doing here?
They'd regroup 3 times, and then one would be on a breakaway.
Somehow it was always Konstantinov that got the breakaway, and he always went forehand, backhand, and scored.
Konstantinov scores!
Gave a different flavor to our team. It was a good surprise element. I was always fearful that somebody could figure out what they were doing because we couldn't ourselves.
On December 26, 1996, the Russian 5 made history at Joe Louis Arena versus the Washington Capitals.
Look at the change of motion there. Larionov to Konstantinov to Fedorov. He scores! Oh my, that is pretty!
The Russian 5 were out there together, and it was a clinic in passing and puck control.
Fedorov by himself.
It was an incredible night, Sergei scoring 5.
The first Red Wing ever to score 5 goals in a single game.
A fantastic accomplishment individually, but collectively for that group, it was a pretty special night. Fetisov, Larionov, Konstantinov, Kozlov, and Fedorov, they just had a way to manufacture the whole thing, and it was incredible to watch. We were very blessed to have the Europeans that we had, starting with those Russians.
You know, the Red Wings may be located in Detroit, but a big part of their success can be traced back to Russia. It's the Russian 5 of Fetisov, Fedorov, Konstantinov, Larionov, and Kozlov. Now, in Russia, they're known as some of the best to ever play the game, but in order for that reputation to be established here, they must win the Stanley Cup. And as Sandra Neal tells us, that would put the punctuation mark on a group nicknamed the Wizards of Oz.
The Motor City, Motown, home of the Jackson 5, the Fab 5, and now the Russian 5.
Back to Larionov. Out to the left point, Konstantinov, cross ice, Fetisov, back up on your side, center off, and
it was only inevitable that once they had the freedom to go and play in the best league in the world, that they would add something to the league.
If someone would have told me 10 years ago that you would all be together.
I would never probably thought about when I came in 1990 and joined Red Wings to play with any Russian 17, you know.
And who'd have thunk this perestroika puzzle started with the draft? Fedorov and Konstantinov in 89, Kozlov 1 year later. The Wings traded for the final two pieces of a puzzle in 95. Fetisov last season, Larionov last fall.
I said right away that would be great to have Igor on our team as a player and as a person, because 10 years ago, when I joined Red Army, I was just a kid, 15, 16 years old, trying to learn hockey, and those guys was playing great hockey ever being played. Actually, I was very excited.
So far, it's my best season in the National Hockey League. Of course, to be playing with the four Russian guys alongside, of course, make your job easier.
Though all five players have strong roots in Russian finesse hockey, don't accuse them of playing soft. In fact, opponents claim just the opposite.
You know, that people say a dirty player, they can say whatever they want. You know, I want to just play my game, like aggressive style of hockey, like I've been playing in Russia, same style.
Well, you always, you know, hit clean first power 10 minutes of the game, you know. He's very tough, and players doesn't like it, and they start playing dirty against him.
Referees, they give us, you know, some 10 minutes penalties, so we're yelling Russian at them, and I know what's going on now.
Okay, so maybe speaking Russian on the ice has no advantages, but it does create a family atmosphere, especially for Kozlov, its youngest member.
Have these guys become like brothers to you then?
Slava like father.
For the Red Wings, Larionov, to Fedorov, to Fetisov, he scores!
Russia, with love.
Fetisov, Konstantinov, Kozlov, and Larionov to Konstantinov, to Fedorov, he scores! The Russian five, strike first.
It's a different style of hockey than we're used to. You can sometimes get frustrated playing against them because they have such good puck control.
Now Fedorov back for Kozlov. Goes back to Fedorov.
They just have that sixth sense. They're on the same wavelength.
It's all basically the same. We have a base, you know, of understanding each other very well because of the school we went through together, which is Russian school.
Tisov, Kozlov, Larionov. Out there, Fedorov to Konstantinov.
There's a number of times where we sit on the bench you know, they do these passes or do these different plays, and you'll be going, what are they doing? And all of a sudden, they got a breakaway or a two-on-one. Or, oh, okay.
Look at this. He's got it. Fedorov by himself. Looking at Fedorov. Oh, knock.
They feed off of one another. They read off of one another. I think that you look at the two older ones, Fetisov and Larionov, they do a lot of talking with the younger ones. They certainly do require special attention, and we're going to pay special attention to them.
The first thing I probably come to mind is not fault for their when they exchange the places on the ice. They like to circle and pass.
And look at this, the Harlem Globetrotters music anytime now.
Try and make confuse all those, you know, players who play against us with all those movements by skating and by passing. Not every time, but when we can.
I think the way Gusarov and I play against them is we realize if we start running around, we're going to get lost in our end, and that's when they're going to take advantage of us.
When you get on the face off and you start speaking Russian,
so nobody knows.
What about what's going on there?
What are we saying?
To Larionov. Out to the left wing, Konstantinov, cross ice, Fetisov, back up on your side, better on the side! What a tape to tape to tape. Bingo, bango, there she goes, that was.
Prompted Scotty Bowman to do what no other NHL coach had been able to do. In certain situations, ice a team of five Russians and one goalie, and not just any five Russians, but five internationally renowned stars. No matter how they have been used, the Russians have had a lot to do with one of the best regular seasons in NHL history, as the Wings try for their record-tying 60th win tonight. They are the subject of a TSN Inside Sports documentary report, Soviet Reunion, the Russian Red Wings.
He breaks down with Kozlov.
Sergei Fedorov. Igor Larionov. Vyacheslav Kozlov. Vladimir Konstantinov. Vyacheslav Fetisov. Five exceptional Russians playing on a National Hockey League club. players have been making their mark in the NHL since the late 1980s, their individual performances have never quite captured the mercurial quality of the team-oriented Russian game. There was a time when we feared the Russians were coming. With this season's incarnation of the Detroit Red Wings, they finally arrived. Until the late 1980s, unforgettable Cold War battles were waged on ice. We were torn between resentment and admiration for the Soviets' seemingly robotic discipline and their flat displays of emotion. On both sides of the Iron Curtain, it was unthinkable that Russians might play in North America.
I want to play with three different generations of hockey players, and all of them was skillful and fast, and they can play any league in the world, but, you know, its system, communist system, didn't allow them to play anywhere else outside of Soviet Union.
For most of the 1980s, Vyacheslav Fetisov and Igor Larionov served the Soviet national team as part of a five-man unit. While North American coaches are perpetually juggling three-man forward lines and defensive pairings, Soviet coaches, the legendary Viktor Tikhonov in particular, have long been working with five-man units. In the 80s, the Soviets had Krutov, Larionov, and Makarov, the famous KLM line, backed up by Kazatonov and Fetisov. The Soviet Big Five played together 8 years, in two Olympics and eight world championships.
We've been playing only for gold medals. Even silver medals was a big tragedy for us.
Slava Fetisov and Igor Larionov were the first to break free from Viktor Tikhonov and the tyrannical Russian hockey system. Out of respect for the Russian people, they waited until the system bowed to Glasnost, Mikhail Gorbachev's mandate for social reform.
People in the Soviet Union, I mean, they love the hockey team, and we was like heroes there. I have many chances and opportunities to escape and defect, but it's what my priority, and doesn't know what to do. And the system was expect from me those, because, you know, they can tell people, you see, we raise him, we give him everything, they, you know, and finally he's exchanged, you know, homeland for the dollars, and, you know, it's, I cannot put myself in this position.
They endured threats. Sticks and pucks were the only things that distinguished the Red Army Hockey Club from the Red Army.
I never handled a gun, I don't know how to shoot, but, you know, I've been in the Army, I have a rank who can help me. Minister of Defense last time called me up and said, you know, you have to be quiet, and otherwise I can send you, you know, pretty far, you never, everybody forget about you.
A generation of nearly 50 Russian NHL players are reaping the benefit of their actions. They miss their homeland, and they worry about its future.
I always think Russia is home, because I see many people in North America very proud of what they, where they're born, where they became, to be here, what they are. Even my teammates, you know, they're very proud of what they come from, you know, even small little towns in North Canada.
Russia's changing, but it's upcoming election, and you don't know what's going to happen. And people who is old, they're angry in the system, and when the communist back, and it's going to be a scary moment.
I just wish the country will follow the good steps of a free market economy and the freedom.
I have grave of my, you know, grave of my relatives there, and I have roots there, and I have to be back. We always fight for freedom, and we never have this before in Soviet Union, but now, all human beings, they have to have a chance in life to choose what they want to do.
In 1989, Igor Larionov landed in Vancouver. In New Jersey, Slava Fetisov encountered teammates who didn't want Russians taking NHL jobs.
It was very difficult. It's language barrier and culture and all this stuff. It was a big problem in the beginning. And and different system team was playing when I start with and coaches and all this stuff and even partners and I know now they hate me, my partners, my dressing room, they hate me because I was coming.
Igor Larionov has a diplomatic memory.
I'm just glad and Slava and I, we made this kind of opportunity for the younger guys to be playing National Hockey League, enjoying the lifestyle and like make a history.
The Detroit Red Wings management has been the most aggressive of all NHL clubs in acquiring Russian talent. The team now has more Russians than any other. Russian players constitute nearly a quarter of the roster and a third of their recent draft picks. Scott Bowman must have learned something from the three defeats he endured in international tournaments against Soviet teams, but the Red Wings coach downplays his strategy in assembling the first five-man unit in the history of the NHL.
The team has had Sergei Fedorov and Slava Kozlov and Vladimir Konstantinov. Last year we made the addition of Vyacheslav Fetisov at the deadline and it really helped because we were, you know, we needed some depth in defense and then he came back this year and has had an excellent season. We made the trade for Igor Larionov on the fact that we knew what he was like because we played San Jose the last 2 years and he was a quality player that was very creative and then when we did get him, we decided that these five players play a unique style and we could put them together on most occasions.
Others see Bowman's intentions differently.
That was kind of his idea, his dream about to put five Russians together.
He hasn't really said it, but it's almost seemed like it's kind of like it's been his goal to put that kind of a unit together. And when the chance came to get Larionov, he jumped at it.
One day he was thinking, I have a little, obviously, some power to maybe make this dream come through.
I think it's a pride thing with Scott, even though he says no. I think it's something that he thought would be a great byproduct of this trade is that he could be the first coach in the National Hockey League to put together a five-man unit of Russians.
I never dreamed to play in the same in the Russian unit and play for the team who have like red colors, Detroit Red Wings. So it's like be back in the red uniform again.
I'll be perfectly honest with you. When we got Igor and knew we were going to put the unit together, I mean we were, you know, a little bit skeptical because we just didn't want our dressing room to be divided. We didn't want to have the five Russians and the rest of the guys, but these five guys are great, great human beings, great hockey players.
I was a little bit nervous because first time ever in National Hockey League, their five-man unit will play together and a lot of expectation, a lot of pressure.
In the beginning, the English and Russian languages competed in the Red Wings dressing room. Paul Coffey approached Slava Fetisov.
It wasn't a hardball thing or anything like that. I just felt that, you know, if we're going to communicate on the same ice out there, that we, you know, if at all possible, should try to speak the same language.
Bowman plays his five-man unit together for the first time October 27, 1995. They play like blood brothers, delivering on their second shift.
Edward Chuck hits a rebound score!
The Wings five-man Russian unit is symbiotic in scoring, but each man has a strikingly distinct talent and personality. Sergei Fedorov may be the most gifted among them.
Ah, Sergei Fedorov.
He is the first Russian to win both the Hart and Frank J. Selke trophies.
It was a great experience, and I was most happiest person in the world.
Does Sergei dream of winning the Hart this year? Yes, but for now he's keeping that hope under his hat, literally. When Slava Fetisov is asked to compare his best years to the performance of Fedorov now, he doesn't hesitate.
He's better than I, it's for sure. I know it's got tremendous skill and skating ability. It's unbelievable.
I don't know. Depends how much skill you got on you.
Sergei is that rare commodity among players. He is as fluid skating backward as forward most of the time. What has it meant to Sergei to play with his boyhood heroes, Slava Fetisov and later Igor Larionov?
It was amazing. Never thought in my deepest dreams, or if people would tell me 10 years ago I will be end up playing North America with those keep watching. Come on, get a laugh, you know. Leave me alone or something like that, you know.
The veterans were equally excited.
He shoots, he scores!
He's one of the best hockey players in the National Hockey League today. And of course, when I arrived in this team, and this was a thrill for me to play with Sergei.
Both as a unit and when mixing with other lines, the Russians have become the main force on this Red Wings roster. Sergei Fedorov, with the crucial support of veteran superstars Steve Yzerman and Paul Coffey, is perhaps the man more than any other who is to carry the Wings on his shoulders this spring.
You're the first person who told me that, but I like that. I think I like that pressure. I like people saying that because it just motivate me to play better.
Gifted goal scorer Vyacheslav Kozlov is a spirited but intensely shy man. He struggles both with culture shock and with the lasting impact of a car accident in Moscow that took the life of a teammate and nearly cost him his own life.
I spent three months in the hospital in Moscow. When I was in Russia, I was like a fancy player over there, and big star. And sometimes I make some mistakes, you know. And when I came here, changed my life.
Kazi, as he prefers to be called, may always wonder.
If I don't have a car accident, maybe I play better than I am right now.
Defenseman Vladimir Konstantinov currently leads the league in the plus-minus category. But for a team-oriented Russian, individual statistics mean little.
It doesn't matter plus-minus because it's more important now play like defensive hockey because it's playoffs hockey.
Number 16 serves his defense by any means necessary.
But Konstantinov playing the role of Ty Cobb.
Konstantinov is dangerous on offense when opportunity knocks.
Konstantinov with a steal! Penalty shot fashion, he's in a load up, oh, pray! Yes.
This disarmingly gentle fellow walks softly, but he skates with a big stick.
People say they can say whatever they want. I want to play like aggressive style hockey and play tough game against like everybody. Doesn't matter if he is star or not.
His team is Slava Fetisov, who many have called the Bobby Orr of Russia, is the self-deprecating and eloquent elder statesman of this five-man unit.
Slava has such a presence, he's such a class act, that it doesn't matter what country he's playing in or what line of work he was in, that he has such an aura around him, that he's a natural leader and people will gravitate towards him because he's articulate and very bright and worldly.
Now in the final years of his storied career, Slava has reveled in the opportunity to play with this historic five-man unit.
When we start clicking, it was lots of fun here. And guys get their memory back, and especially for myself, and probably for Igor too, to get those feelings back. It was just unbelievable, and we had fun, and I didn't feel my age now.
In Russia, they call Igor Larionov the professor. Now he's adored by his students at Red Wings University.
To help progress my game, I can jump up more than I used to be, and I can rush the attack too, because when Igor gets the puck, I knew he gave to me pass all the time.
In previous seasons, Kozlov was one Red Wings scorer to watch. This season, with the support of Larionov, he can be the hottest scorer on a given night.
He helped me a lot on the ice and in my life too.
My game is simple, you know. I'm playing my role in this unit, like be a link between forwards and defense. So I play like a dispatcher or a conductor.
He told me, don't worry, relax. We start play each other, and I start score the goals.
It's the biggest thing is he's kind of put them all together, all five guys, and they've grown together since he's got here and got even better as the seasons went on.
Closest thing to Wayne Gretzky. They have the same size, they see the ice as well. They both make great, great passes.
Exceptional individual talents, these Russian Red Wings stand out when they're deployed on any line. In the five-man unit, these stars shine more brightly when they form the ever-varying constellations that result in their goals. Even when they retreat or lose possession of the puck, it's hard to escape thinking they're in control. If we must choose three words to describe what's in the four of the five-man unit's collective mind, they would be these. Team, team, team.
This name, I mean, it doesn't matter what they have on the back, you know, if you don't think in, for the team, you know, going to produce for the team.
When you got together, so we didn't really like think who's going to be leader of this unit. We're playing for each other. It's a Soviet-Russian style mentality, you know. Who cares? We're playing for each other, we're playing for the team.
Well, that's different because they have a lot, they pass it back a lot, and they pass it back into our own end quite a few times, and they like to make a lot of cross-ice passes. But they're, I mean, they're potent in the opposition's end. I mean, they're hard to keep track of. I mean, once they give it away, they're so good away from the puck, and that's what makes them so good.
It's been an honor, really. It's been a lot of fun to sit back and watch these guys, you know, let alone in games, in practices. Their ability is in conditioning is so superior.
They play a different brand of hockey than we play. And we're more of an up and down, straight ahead with the puck, and they like to do a lot of crisscrossing and zigzagging and whatnot. So they're a nice change for our team, and they offset the other lines on our team and give the other team something different to look at.
These five Russians have contributed more than a third of their team's goals and total points. They are the nucleus of a club that is not just the runaway President's Trophy winner for 1995-96, but one of the best regular season NHL teams ever assembled. Now the Russian Red Wings have their eyes on the prize, the Stanley Cup.
The most gorgeous part of it when you really, you know, have the trophy in your hands. I dream about Stanley Cup and it's something else.
Stanley Cup means for me, like, I think everything, because it's just one title left I want to win.
I won Olympics and the World Championships, and you're playing just 10 games or 8 games tournament. This is going to be like marathon, playing 82-game season and then playing 4 rounds in playoffs.
I never won Stanley Cup, and it's probably tough tough to compare, but it's all best players now play here, and everybody want to be the winner, and everybody dreams to win the cup.
There's the best teams on a planet, on the world, you know, and of course I would be so happy if it happened this year, and would be like the best memory for me to win the Stanley Cup.
This photograph of the 1954-55 Stanley Cup champions hangs prominently in the Detroit Red Wings dressing room. 1996 offers the team a great opportunity to hang another team picture beside it. For the Russian Red Wings, the achievement will be special. It will be the closest the Red Army has ever come to winning professional hockey's Holy Grail. More importantly, though, it will send a resounding message home that the Glasnost dreams of freedom and success, at least for these exceptional five, came true. Goal the team, the five Russians, have combined for more than 300 scoring points. And short of trying to determine exactly how many goals have been scored with the involvement of one or more of the Russians, let's just say it's plenty. And that goes for the goals scored with the exclusive involvement of Russians, too. They could have their own highlight reel of goals scored after intricate passing plays, and it could serve as the league's best. Once upon a time, an NHL team with such a Russian flavor would have been unthinkable. And at a later time, after it did become possible, it would have been questioned or criticized. And I suppose you can still hear some of that. But if you pay big dollars for an NHL ticket at Joe Louis Arena, surely you want to see the kind of hockey that these guys can play, especially when they're on the ice together.